Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our session on whether over the top and subscription video on demand are the new theatrical and how we should price content in this new streaming universe. Before we dig into in depth of this topic, I'd like to begin by introducing our panelists. First, I'd like to introduce media analyst Ed Hirsch. Ed is the founder of Storycentric, a New York-based consultancy firm that provides strategic insight to producers and networks on development, production, storytelling, and execution. Recent clients include Discovery Communications and WNET in New York. Ed also provides analysis on the rapidly changing media environment. Ed is a veteran producer and media executive, having served in senior roles at ABC News, A&E Networks, and others. And he's also on the adjunct faculty of Syracuse University's Newhouse School of Public Communications, where he teaches on programming and storytelling. So welcome, Ed.
Hi. How are you?
Good. So next, I'd like to introduce Jessica Berman Bogdan. Jessica is the president and founder of Global Image Works, which is an independent archive and media company, which licenses contemporary and archival stock footage and photos. It also offers a full range of audiovisual research and rights clearance services. Jessica herself is an internationally recognized film researcher. She's been an archival producer on documentaries such as Kurt Cobain, 20 Feet from Stardom, The Beatles, 8 Days a Week, and many others. She's also a founding member of the footage trade organization AXL, Association of Archival of Commercial Stock Image Licensors, which recently merged with DMLA this past year. Welcome, Jessica.
Hi.
And we also have Brian Sargent, who's the Managing Director of Licensing for Fox Archives in New York. This includes the brands and catalogs of the Fox Movietone Newsreel, Fox News Channel, Fox Business Network, and Fox Television Stations. Before establishing the department 3 years ago, Brian was a founder and photographer for Five Borough Films. Brian spent 15 years with ITN, Independent Television News Archives in the UK, and is currently overseeing a large-scale television presentation project for New Fox. Welcome, Brian.
Thank you.
And last but not least, I am the director of footage sales and licensing at WGBH Boston, which is the largest public television station and creator of content for the PBS system. We license footage, audio, text, and web content from our 60-plus-year-old program archive. I also negotiate stock footage and stills deals for WGBH Productions. So I license in and I license out. Prior to this, I directed archival research on PBS documentaries and worked as a film researcher and associate producer. In addition, I was also a charter member of AXL, and until recently, I served on its board of directors. So that is that's who we all are. And I'd like to begin by just looking at a few slides in case some people are not aware or unfamiliar with some of the terminology, which is a little strange. I mean, we do tend to think of streaming as streaming, but it also has certain terms that, you know, we'll refer to throughout this presentation. But I also thought I would amuse everyone by showing you what I woke up to this morning. I live in Brookline, Massachusetts, and it was snowing. And guess what? It still is. So anyway, just moving along, we are going to be talking about the new streaming universe, which includes OTT, which is an antiquated term at this point, but it means over the top, and it refers to any streaming service that delivers content via the internet. The five top streaming services are Netflix, Amazon, YouTube, Disney, and Hulu. Some other terms that are sort of interchangeable with this are direct to consumer. That involves a content provider offering content directly to consumers on a subscription basis, such as Disney, rather than providing content to pay providers. And then, of course, there's subscription video on demand, which is in essence direct to consumer, where users pay a monthly fee in exchange for instant access to a streaming library. consisting of movies, TV shows, and other media content. So I think it would be, let's get started, and I'd like to ask Ed to weigh in, I guess, and describe the current media landscape for us and why some people are describing this period as the archival holy grail.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. In some ways, it's the archival holy grail. And on the other hand, we'll throw some more cliches around, it's the perfect storm, because the combination of the holy grail part is, if you can't go out and produce content, right, and you have to wear masks, and now we're having a second wave, in many ways, networks and producers are looking to create programming as impact-free as possible in terms of COVID and getting out there. And what more perfect way to do that is through archival work. You can ship a camera kit, and to interview subjects, and you can produce archival programs that way. It exists, you don't have to go out and shoot it. So at the very least, there's this tremendous content, you know, desert right now producers and networks are looking for content, and and certainly archival content is great. So it's easy to make easy, not gonna say easy. You think about obviously how you make programs. If you can make a program remotely accessing archives and doing minimal interviews, and you're doing your post-production remotely, as many places are, there's a tremendous need for programming, and archival programming fills that need. We're also in an interesting period of history, if you think about it, right? Of course, the election, Black Lives Matter, a pandemic, all of which have tremendous roots in history. And so, of course, archival, there's lots of archive to talk about that. How many times have we seen the, Nixon, Kennedy debates in the last couple of weeks? How many times have we seen pictures from the 1918 pandemic in recent months? So we're in an interesting inflection point in history where past is prologue. So there's an enormous desire for that, and so I think that's why, from a production point of view, archive is important. And in terms of stream, that doesn't really get to streaming. And also, I'm happy to talk about streaming now or later, whenever you.
Well, maybe we'll just talk a little bit more about archive, and if Jessica or Brian want to just weigh in. I mean, I know we are seeing a huge uptick in people wanting material. So if you guys want to just quickly weigh in on that, then we can talk about the streaming.
Well, I certainly see a huge uptick. And I think, you know, in conversation with colleagues, both on the research side and on the production or the library side, everybody is seeing that. I think several projects have been not only started because there's a huge need for content. There are so many streaming platforms. So this has been a huge uptick, but also a lot of projects have actually been pushed. Their schedules and timelines have been compressed, and they're producing them at a much faster rate. Things that took 6, 9 months in a year are turning around very, very quickly. So, yes, and you watch, their documentaries are all over every one of the platforms.
Absolutely true.
For the nonfiction side, I think, features is another story.
Ryan?
Yeah, no, I mean, I agree, but to call that surfacing that material is not easy, and it's not cheap. When in March, when the pandemic broke out and the global economy came to a screeching halt, you saw something that you never saw before. And that was oil prices. Oil prices dropped. They went to zero. And then the longer the pandemic went on, they turned negative. And so you say, how can that be? This is a valuable commodity. Why would this thing be worthless? And why would I have to pay for it? But Maersk and British Petroleum don't make money on oil. They make money on the distribution of oil. So that applies to the archive. It's once that asset is broadcast, it's value has been extracted, and then it becomes a, you know, to save it becomes a drain on equity. So what traditionally happens is the stations look at these things and go, oh, this is worthless. We've got our value out of it. Let's just park it somewhere or throw it out. There's no incentive to save the material after it's been broadcast. So what you find is that usually, if it hasn't been thrown away, it's usually been stored underground in a basement, just sitting there waiting to be for a moment like this, where, you know, this thing is, these collections have been neglected for a long, long time. And all of a sudden there's a short-term incentive to go and make use of them, go and turn them into, you know, usable assets, but they're in a state that is not discoverable and is not easily accessible. It's on a tape format. It needs to be digitized. So it's a huge lift to get that into producers' hands.
Yeah, so I guess the point being that there's a lot of demand for content, but it's not always readily available. I mean, things are, so the archives are scrambling right now, but we're also delighted that everyone wants content. So it's a good thing. It's a good thing.
It's a good thing, but only since 2008 are things digital. Prior to 2008, it's film, it's tape, and it's obsolete formats that are different.
Absolutely.
They're not easy.
But as someone who's been both a buyer and a seller and a producer, with all due respect to the archives themselves, right? As a producer, that's your issue, right? Some places like NBC and CBS, they moved very early. I'm not knocking Fox. What I'm just saying is in corporately, that they moved to digitize and to catalog their archives. So you're separating the fact that as one supplier, it's hard for you to supply this, but on a demand point of view, there is demand, and there are some places that, you know, are servicing, you know, did this for a long time and have, you know, some of the networks. So I just think we need to separate the fact that there's demand for it. A different issue that you're talking about is how as a company you monetize that, right?
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I think if we stay, I think the point right now is that there is demand, and it's a good thing for the archives.
Right. And what is the market? What is the market discovery for that archive? What's the value to you, Ed, of digitizing this material?
Right.
Well, from my perspective, I think what happened in the industry when this whole pandemic started, it was easy for some and very difficult for others. Because in a network environment or a large situation like what Brian is talking at Fox or some of the other networks, unless the material was digitized, nobody was getting access to what was in storage and undigitized because nobody was in an office. You know, nobody was there physically manning the scanners and all. So that became very difficult for some. And, you know, for others, I mean, we were able to easily migrate ourselves into without any problem because we had access to everything and we had it all set up and we're a smaller company. It was very different. So I think that that's a challenge that the pandemic brought for some. And I am getting crazy power surges. Jeez, we have a terrible rainstorm here. I hope you don't lose me. I'll figure it out, although I do have a backup generator. We shall see. Anyway, and I think what's really interesting amongst the whole DMLA group is the different types of content providers. Because for us sitting here, we are a deeper content library and not just a stock shot library. And there's a whole different set of rules in providing what's involved in providing what and digitizing it. I think, you know, we have to look at that in the bigger scheme of things as well. In providing deeper content, there is a whole bunch of other, and rights manage content. And that's the other thing, you know, which we can get into later when we talk about other areas.
Yeah, and so let's sort of move to streaming at this point, because it's very much part of the whole what's going on right now. So Ed, if you wanted to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, and I'd love to hear what others feel about this, not just from a more helicopter perspective, not necessarily from our individual businesses, but because I think that, you know, what you're seeing is, and you see the headlines every day are, I think that you might want to say that most companies, I think, are agnostic about platforms, right? Unless you're a platform company. If you're a cable company, you want people to watch cable. But if you're a studio, right? And you just want the most number of eyeballs. And I think you want your content to go, the adult expression, fish where the fish are, right? Distribute where the eyeballs are. And so, think about how the distribution methods have changed over the years. And, you could only watch, some movie from the 70s in a theater. And now there is, you can watch it on Netflix, Amazon, everywhere else, right? The movie's the same, right? The content is the same. The audience migrated, the technology changed. So in many ways, your question, SVOD, the new theatrical? Yes, because there are more eyeballs there. I mean, think about if you're a nonfiction producer or a scripted producer. I pulled out some fun fact here. Netflix premiered, Netflix has a documentary, a series, a crime documentary, which they've become, has become a huge genre for them, a true crime documentary. That it's called American Murder, The Family Next Door. This is just yesterday, has become its most watched doc feature to date. The streamer, which posted its third quarter financials, revealed the true crime doc is projected to be watched by 52 million subscribers in its first 28 days. This makes it the best performing feature doc. Okay. And next to The Social Dilemma, which was the media documentary on social media, 38 million households. Now, if you're an indie doc producer, okay, and you get your film into the Lincoln Square, which sadly doesn't exist anymore, Lincoln Plaza Theater and Hope or Film Forum and Hope people go, and isn't that great? And boy, we got, how many people are going to see it? Okay, versus, okay, you sell it to Amazon, you sell it to Netflix, and it's everywhere. Look at the debate now. There was a deal in place to sell the new James Bond movie for $500 million to Apple Plus. Okay, and that's because they have nowhere to show it, right? And who's gonna wanna go back to the theater, right? And so it's two things have come together. One, the COVID crisis, but also technology, right? That you now can get it, the broadband, more people have broadband, people are cutting the cord. So I think the answer to your question at the bottom of the screen is yes, 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 and yes, because that's where people are. And as the more people get broadband, as more people cut the cord, right, people just want to get their films, their product, in front of as many people as possible. And my other favorite fun fact is that RBG, the great documentary, which, by the way, did great in the theaters. It made $15 million in the theaters. The box office of $14 million. But in 4 months after it premiered on TV, 4 months after its theatrical premiere, okay, and brought over a million viewers to CNN when it premiered, in the first weekend when it premiered. Now that's many, many more people that would ever see it in a theater. So is the back end, can you make as much money, right? If you're gonna get a piece of the box office, right, you're going to have to pre-negotiate that now, right? You're going to have to figure out how much you're going to get up front, and that's going to be a negotiation. It's not based on how many tickets you sell. But I think that really is part of a trend of going where you put your content where the audience is. And I assume you guys, I'm agnostic about pricing, because I buy and sell, but those of you who represent archives and those of you who buy from archives, I assume that's going to be a matter of negotiation, right?
Well,
totally.
Go ahead, Jessica.
Go ahead.
No, you go.
No, I'm just going to say, I found a couple of things that interesting. I was looking for some numbers as well. And because of really, I think, technology, theatrical window time has reduced. And you might be able to verify this as well, Ed. I think in 2012, the theatrical window average was like 102 days before it went to a streaming platform or home video. And in 2017, it was down to 94. And pre-pandemic, it was down to 74 days.
And so, you make a great point, by the way. I also had in my notes. So I'm glad you made it. Which is, a lot of these forces that we're talking about here today were in place before the pandemic, but that just sprayed gasoline, on that fire, right? That Disney was already. I know at one point Disney was already talking about shortening the window, and of course the theater owners were screaming about it, and it was a big matter of negotiation. But to your point, Jessica, exactly, that was underway, and now with theaters closed and nobody wanted to go to the theater, they just said, we're just going to go direct to streaming.
Yeah,
and they've created PVOD. I'm sorry, go ahead, Brian.
No, I was just going to say Netflix had the same issue with the theater chains with the Irishman, where they wanted to release it concurrently, right, and the theaters rejected that. So, yeah. So there was a movement ahead, right?
And they've created the new acronym PVOD, PVOD, which is premiere VOD. So now, instead of going to a theater, you can pay $20.29 or whatever the number is, and get those first runs that normally would be in the theater, but now you can see it in your living room at a 60-inch screen or whatever, and that's a whole other interesting thing.
Well, yeah, and just to that point, there was a New York Times article a couple Fridays ago, I think two Fridays ago, and I'm quoting from the article, which said, "What if the pandemic, rather than representing a temporary disruption in audience habits and industry revenues, turns out to be an extinction level event for movie going?" So it's like, here we find ourselves. The reason it's relevant to us is because to date, the way we've always licensed content, theatrical has been the top tier. It's been the most expensive thing that you would license for. So really, to my mind, Brian and I had a whole exchange about this, because I went to license something from Brian, and Brian said, "Well, now wait a minute. If you're going to stream on third-party platforms, I'm considering that should be a higher rate because you're seeing many more eyeballs." So,
yeah, that was my definition of all media, was included OTT and SOV and however you want to categorize it, characterize it, but it was not a transferable license in our mind.
And I think it's an interesting new development, because again, as I said, this was always the top tier. There would be film festivals, then limited theatrical, then full theatrical, and you paid top dollar for full theatrical. And now I think we're having to rethink that. What's your view on that, Jessica?
No, I totally think we have to rethink it. I don't think theatrical has gone away. What's interesting to me, because on the research side, when I put that hat on, and productions that I'm working as an archival producer, what I'm seeing is that a lot of the bigger projects are holding their release for 2022. And my understanding from what I've heard is that the theatrical windows for 2021, summer 2021, they're booked. They actually have booked all of the slots. And if you are coming in and looking to book something, you have to move it to 2022. So people are still having faith in the communal experience of going to a theater. I don't think that's going to go away, but I think it has morphed. And I also read something just the other day, which really blew my mind, is that there's a new technology that if you're going to buy into this PVOD, there'll be sensors to see how many people are watching it in a room to try to track if it's like a family of 10, if you've got people, there's all sorts of things happening. So, but I do believe it's a new theatrical. I think we really have to look at what's going on in that area. But at the same time, for the smaller independent producers, it is an opportunity, even on a smaller streaming platform, to get their content sold in opportunities that never existed before. And so the challenge for us is to figure out, do you charge, you know, what are your fees? Is it on this level? And we can get into how we had looked at this as Axel and the whole idea of licensing, and it's a conversation of where the funding source is and how many eyeballs. It's all about the eyeballs and where the money's coming from.
Absolutely. And Allison, I think the question is, you know, that I saw that same article, and I, you know, extinction level event. How many times have moved, right, when television, you know, radio was going to kill, television was going to kill radio, right? And movies, and then television was going to kill.
They did. They.
but in terms of television killing movies, right? Movies changed, right? There are still movies like, I'll wait to go, sure, if there's nowhere else to see it, I'll see No Time to Die on my, I live in an apartment, so I only have a 50-inch plasma, but not my 75-inch, but I'll watch there, but I want to see it in IMAX, and I want to see it around with a lot of people. So I'll wear full PPE and go there at some point to see it. And, you know, so think about how movies, you know, blockbusters, The Avengers, things like that, things that look great on a big screen with big audio, movies changed to get people there. And then there are movies, you know, documentaries, smaller films, smaller films, documentaries that you
art films
watch on a good TV, right? So the platforms, you know, we've all, think about, you know, television, right? That the soap opera came about because it was easy to shoot, you know, tight faces, there weren't big exteriors, and it worked well. News works well on TV. So I think that over time, platforms evolve to, content evolves to fit the platform. And because producers are smart, they want people to see stuff. So movies are doing just fine, but it's a certain kind of movie now, right?
Well, it's an interesting question. Brian, you were about to say something?
I was just going to say that the owners of that intellectual property of radio and television, they suppressed television for 20 years in order to extract the most value out of their radio platforms. So that has been going on, where you're leveraging the technology and suppressing other technologies.
Well, and also it's kind of an interesting point. I mean, you know, sort of the big feature film fiction docs, fiction programs, shows, they will probably remain in the theater, but what about documentaries? I mean, maybe they won't, you know?
The question is, though, you know, documentaries, and you know, Jessica, you're dealing much more with documentary filmmakers than Allison, but, you know, for the longest time, at least from my perspective, theatrical for documentaries was never really a money-making thing. It was, you know, they sold them on DVDs or they sold them to networks, but it was an award. It was a festival and buzz building and, you know, you had to hold things, you had to four-wall something for two weeks in order to get it considered for the Oscars and stuff like that. So how big a actual market has for documentaries and nonfiction been, you know, in the last 5 or 10 years?
Oh, I think it has definitely increased. There, it is not just the Academy consideration window. I wouldn't say if it's a higher budget doc and those have multiplied, you know, from the swath of music docs, profile docs, the RGBs, you know, there's a whole gamut that had a really strong theatrical window, which allowed the buzz, I think, and the talk, so that when it hit the cable, it brought the eyeballs even further. But
you know what it is, Jessica? It's there's finally parity between theatrical and television, because it really is about the cost of that product to create.
Yes.
And if you're talking about 8K televisions, well, no one's going to adopt that because it's astronomical to fund the content for that. But now you're seeing 4K theatrical and 4K television. You know, they can live anywhere, but that's because of the production costs behind them. They're equal.
But also, I mean, actually, Ed, I mainly deal with documentary filmmakers. They're mainly coming to the archive to license content all the time. That's almost exclusively who we're licensing to. And it runs the gamut from crime to historical to...
I only meant the theatrical. Oh, no, there's a huge market for documentaries. And look at Netflix and, you know, with right. and these, some of these buzzy, you know, the Tiger King and all that stuff that are amazing. My only question is for documentaries, is the theatrical run. And Jessica, you say, yes, right, for an RBG and others, but are there, it seems that the Netflix and stuff have created a new market there for documentaries on television, right? You couldn't get all those into a theater at some point. You go up to Hot Docs in Toronto and you watch all these fabulous documentaries, many of them never to be heard from again, right? And the streaming channels have created a new market.
That's exactly
for true. Documentaries.
Correct.
Yeah, I mean, I think I see questions about budgets, which people are asking, which I think is fascinating too, and something, the budgets, for most of the docs hasn't changed. I don't think our pricing, our license fees have changed either in over a decade. And the streaming platforms are pushing greater grant of rights. I mean, this is the age old story, greater rights for no more money. And it then filters back to us and you know, well, you know, we really want to use it and it's a passion project and blah, 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 blah. But again, I mean, it's difficult for, I think, for licensors because we want to support the industry. We believe in a lot of it. We love our footage. We want to see it used. And yet we have to keep our doors open. And to Brian's point, there is a cost to providing this material, digging it out, storing it, digitizing it, making it available, logging it, answering the phone, being here, you know, doing all of that, which always just blows my mind that people don't understand that it's a cost of doing business. And I think our industry has shifted so greatly insofar as there are free footage being given away, there's the royalty free, there's a commodity to it. And then there's the other side where we are not commodities because of the cost that we bear to provide this and an education to the client, because the client doesn't like, wait, why I can get this for free. No, you can't get that for free because this is 100 years old or 50 years old and all the requirements that go in. So,
I think the word, there's a labor intensity to it, right? Intensiveness right. to it that I think a lot of people don't understand. That it's not just you're going, you know, you're typing in, you know, Kennedy Nixon debate, right? And handing that, you know, disc or a thumb drive to somebody. There's a curation function that you guys do. At least I'm sure I know you do, Jessica, and I'm sure you do too, Brian. If I call you and say I'm working on a really important documentary project, I'm trying to show, you know, the politics of the 2020 election and how the media is involved, I'm making that up, you know, because I know you work at Fox. You know, you're not going to just, you know, send me a download of every TV show Sean Hannity has ever done. You know, you're going to work with me to figure out how to do that. And that's something that you need to be compensated for.
Right.
Well, I mean, I think that anyone who, you know, runs an archive or works in an archive, you know, is also a researcher. I mean, that is what you do. You have to research your collection. You have to, as you said, and if you come, you want X, you know, you're going to find X for that person. And it, you know, there are places like Shutterstock, as you were saying, Jessica, they fill a certain niche. Some of the archives with older content, you know, for all kinds of reasons, can't get their content up there. not only due to money, but rights issues, et cetera, so still require, you know, an analog, a person to actually go and dig, you know, through their material. So, but I mean, it's interesting too. I think that in fact, there are some documentaries that maybe are being produced for Netflix and Amazon that in fact do have reasonable budgets, you know, that, that are not a pinching the penny. I remember, Brian, you and I were talking about that. And that, you know, perhaps there might be a producer coming that isn't in fact going to ask, you know, can't you do better for me, whatever. Oh, okay, it's whatever, fine, you know.
Don't forget the different paths to Netflix or Amazon, you know, et cetera, or even to PBS, right? There's the full commission where, you know, that's, talk about holy grail, right? That you pitch an idea to Netflix, I've been working on this, here's a taster tape, and great, you're the Obamas and you're gonna do American Factory, or, you know, you're going to do, you're the Tiger King, and here's, you know, literally tens of millions of dollars to produce that, or Ken Burns, right? And then there's the person who makes an independent documentary, right? Or an independent film where they, you know, they're trying to make the best deal they can, and they make it, maybe gets in a festival, and lo and behold, Netflix says, I love that, you know, we'll take it, okay? So that's a different, that, you know, when you're making that film, price is of, is important. You're cutting every corner. You're working out of your basement, right? If you just got a commission from Netflix because you've tied yourself to Leonardo DiCaprio, no, you're not worried about how much the footage is going to cost. Does that make any sense?
Well, that's a big, huge part of it. And something that as an industry, when that was one of the big things that Axel did when we were looking at licensing and how do you... Well, it goes back to definitions. I was going to just say that we all talk the same language, OTT, SVOD, PVOD, but it means something different to everybody. You know, what is all media? Does all media actually mean all media? And one of the...
It does.
Right. And I think one of the responsibilities as an industry, and something we've all talked about in DMLA, is trying to take definitions. We can't obviously discuss fees and pricing, but we can certainly discuss meanings and definitions so that when a client comes in and wants OTT or wants all media or wants all streaming platforms, it means the same thing to you, Allison, as it means to me, as it means to Brian. And there's an even playing field. And how we interpret that can be different in the sense of fees, you know, I mean, because one of the things that we were talking about with Axel is, again, looking at not only eyeballs, but is it the independent producer? Do you take the independent producer and the very well-funded commissioned or co-pro that you know is going to be a huge success, but do you look at the independent in the same way and give them the same fee structure? You know, it's like theatrical feature film and limited theatrical. I mean, it's the same, and we need to be cognizant of that, I think. And it's the rare occasion that the independent producer has a runaway hit, you know, which would be good for them. And if we didn't make the best deal for us, oh well. But we need to at least push it and get our products in there and make it happen, I think.
And you can't negotiate on behalf of that independent producer. And so you don't know that what kind of deal they made with the large platform. And are they getting a cut of that, or they just make a flat fee? And the upside is all of that large platform's, you know, recouping all of that, right? So they get the all of that profit. Yeah.
The deal's been made.
And we end up underwriting those large platforms who can afford to pay for it. And, you know, so we, you know, it's tough because we want to help and we understand that there's a different price scale for those independent producers. But if they're really making content on behalf of these large portals, then it's It's not
fully in commission. We don't know until after the fact.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things we were talking about is who's making the money here? I mean, is it only Netflix? Is it the independent? Is anything really changed for the independent? You know, that was a question we had too when we were first thinking about this panel.
Well, I think that it's interesting that you say that. You don't know what the deal is. But it's funny, if we were doing a panel of independent producers, they would be saying exactly the same thing that you are, which is, we went out and we made this thing and we got it, and we got a second mortgage, and you know, had a garage sale and a bake sale, and we got this thing made, and now Netflix wants it, okay, and all of a sudden Netflix wants it, okay, and they want to, and they don't want to leave out of want it, they want to license it for 5 years or 10 years, and it's already made. So you know what, you gotta take what you get. And I think it's sort of a similar thing, which is, you don't really have control over the end user of this or the end a distributor of this. And so, you know, it Brian's right. A lot of these films, I'm sure some of the smaller ones that aren't commissioned by Netflix, are in fact underwriting Netflix in a way.
Totally.
Yeah, and the distribution used to be easier to control, right? If you had a DVD, that thing was, you know, region encoded, and you had a hardware to play that. If you couldn't move from region to region without a hardware product, right? You had to actually buy that player. And these days you can pay, you know, for the price of a latte, you can get a VPN and mask your IP and get stuff anywhere in the world. So this regionalizing of content is gone. I see it. It's not quite the same.
Yeah, everything is worldwide. I mean, and everyone basically clears for, well, that's not entirely true. I do
find some geo-blocking, but it's minimal.
Sometimes the European countries do only clear for that country. And then they have a very complicated set of rights that includes, you know, catch up for 15 days and this, that, the other thing. And
French speaking territory.
Yes, exactly. And you're sort of like, just clear all media. You know, it's just,
let me ask a question of you guys then, because I'm sitting here listening, you know, as someone, you know, probably half a step removed from the day-to-day stuff that you guys are all so involved in. Is there a time coming, if you can't differentiate between these things, and as Brian says, you know, you get a VPN, forget about regional encoding, you know, forget about territories, forget about really protecting, you know, copy protecting anything which you can't do. Is the day going to come when basically it's all that it's assumed that it's all media, and
that's all we're seeing.
We're already there.
Yeah, and that's driven by Netflix's policy where they will not license, they will not allow any producer to incorporate footage in their production if it's not an all media license. So if you're making something right for Netflix, that's their requirement. All media in perp.
I mean, I
worldwide.
I don't want to ask you because, it was to Brian's point about this is that, it's a case in point. Jessica, you may be familiar with this too. When I was at Discovery, one of the things we talked to CBS about relicensing for the military channel, one of their smaller channels, the old great CBS series, The 20th Century, which they did a new version of for, I think, A&E or History in the 90s. And we said, we'd love that in bulk. We'll run it during the day, you know, it's all made. And they came back to us and said, the footage was never in perpetuity all media, the outside footage. It's on yellow, to Brian's point earlier, it's on written on yellow legal pads in a cardboard box in Fort Lee, New Jersey, in a warehouse. And that the labor intensity, okay, of the stuff's all sitting there, the finished shows, the labor intensity of going back and re-clearing that footage and seeing if they could re-clear when there's 15 seconds from, you know, Fox movie tone and 15 seconds from Hearst, somebody else, is literally, it's astronomical. They even did a little bit of a study to see how much it would take. And, you know, wind up being, you know, $50,000 an episode. It's crazy. So, is the day going to come when we basically say, you take all rights or you take no rights?
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, as Jessica said earlier, we've been here before. Right. You know, when any new kind of delivery system or technology comes along, everyone always reviews all these things again, like home video was another one. And all media still never includes all media. It just doesn't, because I think the bottom line is that usually people exclude theatrical almost always because it is the most expensive tier. So, and also really everyone's coming to us now and wanting all media. I mean, it's so unusual that we actually have a license that's not that. So it just seems like more and more will be developed, and you know, who knows what new technology will come along. So I don't know.
It's
like nobody here is afraid of their content, you know, showing up, you know, in a church basement, you know, that somebody charges, or at some, you know, college theater where they charge $10 to see it. Everybody's worried about being on Netflix and or getting, you know, getting streamed around the world or pirated. So I think in some ways it's kind of answering the question. You guys don't seem afraid. Theatrical doesn't even seem to matter anymore in this conversation.
What matters is the fees, and unfortunately, an all media worldwide in perp bears a higher fee, which sometimes is unaffordable. We used to see as a consistent, for especially for the smaller independents, is they would grab the film festival or the lowest tier because they could pay that out of pocket and pre-negotiate and build in options so that when they made that great deal, they can then exercise the option. Now, we're seeing less and less of that, and people just know they have to sort of go to the all media tier. And it has become sort of the recipe for the day. You know, I don't think we've made very many lesser and more constrained deals. But again, it's the education behind that and accepting that there's a cost to it and that there is a portion of the industry which has very different definitions than the rights managed definitions. And it becomes very hard for, I think, a user or a licensee to understand the difference. It's old. Why we should get it for very little.
Well, let's see. I think in a minute or two, we'll move to questions, but you know, so we have a number of questions in the chat, but I guess wrapping up at this point, because unfortunately I know that we could just go on all day talking about this, but I don't know. Is there anything that we want to, you know, it seems if everyone would like to sort of give their view as sort of as final words on the topic. I mean, for us personally, I think we are going to probably really look at whether the OTT and SVOD should be a tier that's a step up in the all media.
I think SVOD is, you know, the terms are changing because the landscape is changing. And in my mind, SVOD was attached to a broadcaster.
That's right.
You've got a traditional broadcast model, you need the SVOD. That is going to go away as broadcast goes away.
Right.
It's an all media world. It's an all media worldwide in perp. I think we all need to understand it. It doesn't matter at this point if it's theatrical or streaming platform. I think we just have to sort of come in somewhere in between and make that defined. You know, it might change maybe in 2 years from now, theatrical has a new life in a new world, in a new, you know, and everyone, the value is clearly separate once again. But I think we need to look at all media as at least at this point involving a higher level of streaming platforms as well.
And in some ways, I completely agree. In some ways, you almost have to look at everything now is at some point it's going to be streamed. Maybe if it's not this year or next year or the year after that, it's going to be streamed as more and more of these services come in, as they start, you know, hoovering up more content. And I think what's so hard to know, it dovetails a little bit with our earlier conversation about COVID and all this. How many, we know streaming is here to stay, and we know that they're going to hoover up a lot of content and films and commission stuff themselves. How many of changes in the audience are going to be permanent, and how many, in other words, when we can safely go back to theaters, how much will people want to go back
to theaters? Will people want to?
Their programs they want to see, one. And two, if you're cocooning in your house, okay, and a smaller or family-oriented film, you know, would with a second wave coming, are people's habits going to change? You know, one of my concerns working with a bunch of cable companies that are parenthetically is that people seem to be moving away from, you look at, people are cutting the cord, right? And they're saying this, you know, because of there's no new, a lot of new, not new content, a lot of the broadcast networks have kind of disposable content, at least now, you know, game shows, reboots of game shows or reality shows, just to keep the lights on during this COVID period. Now, is the audience now going to say, you know, I know I do, you guys probably do too, people out here in our group, they used to start at the broadcast networks, then go look at a few cable channels, and then maybe go over to Netflix and Amazon. People are starting at Netflix now. It's their default. And same thing with Amazon Prime. And now you have HBO Max in the game, Peacock, Paramount Plus. So, and people are cutting the cord. So how many of the changes in the audience behavior, which is going to govern a lot of this, is going to be permanent, and how much of it is COVID? And, you know, nobody has the answer to that. Everybody in is having the same conversation in every Zoom meeting that goes on everywhere. So, you know, that to me is the trend that I'm looking for 2021. How many of these things stick? How many of these things go away?
It's when you look at this, though, from a global perspective, what's interesting to me is you've got this American landscape, and over in Europe, there's this hybrid between state produced, state backed productions. And the biggest streamers in Europe are Netflix and Amazon. So they're American companies over there. But then you've got, you know, China, where they've got the equal numbers of platforms, you know, but Netflix isn't allowed in China. Right. And so you're talking about all these companies, and global growth is the goal. Ed, do you see this consolidating at all, or do you see this just, you know, plateauing and getting some kind of equilibrium where?
Well, you know, clearly Netflix is clearly, you know, the giant that everybody's trying to dethrone. But actually, Netflix was down a little bit, some of their subs in the last few months because HBO Max, because of Peacock, and again, my question is, we had cord cutting, right? Everybody looked at these, you looked at your cable bill every month, and you'd say $199 for what, right? And you started cord shaving or cord cutting. At some point, when all your free trials are up and you get your monthly credit card bill, right? And the economy is tough. What everybody's looking at is there a cord cutting, is there a cord cutting 2.0 where you look at that and say, you know what? I have kids, I gotta have Disney. You gotta have Netflix, right? Do I really need Curiosity Stream? Do I really need Hulu, right? And what's the value proposition for paying for Peacock or not? Right, and I think that there's another reckoning coming with that too. But Brian, I think
too much content, too much. You can't figure
it
out.
Too much, it's exhausting. I mean, it just is.
I could spend an hour just going through and figure out what I want to watch.
Me too. You know,
and then it's like, I'm too tired to even bother.
Right. And do I, and think about some of the decisions you're making too. Like, do I really want to invest 8 hours in this? Right. No, I'm going to watch a rerun of Law and Order on Wii TV.
Right? Well, it's easy.
48 minutes long. It ends with credits. I'm not going to wait for a character to be killed off in episode 4 of 8. So I
think that,
right.
You're the old guys.
But you know what? But
not the young ones.
Brian, somebody asked on here, Leslie Hughes, that 20 somethings don't watch TV. They stream 100%.
Right.
And so maybe Quibi's disaster was that they thought that, hey, if they take Hollywood content that people our age want to watch and chop it into 8-minute pieces, that everybody will want that. No, they don't, right? Kids are watching TikTok. They're watching, you know, they're doing stuff on Twitch. They're watching in a different way with their own authentic stars and voices coming from that. You know, Sarah Cooper was on, you know, TikTok before she wound up with a Netflix special. So
right, but Quibi was a result of their death was a result of the pandemic more than anything, isn't it?
Our habits changed.
Yeah, who wants right. to, you know, you're not running anywhere. You can afford to watch something.
But
go ahead, Brian. Then I just like to address some of the questions, but.
Yeah, no, in the US though, you've got an infrastructure for streaming. I mean, if you're going over to even Europe, but my God, the rest of the world has nothing compared to our streaming infrastructure.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, that like I said, we could go on all day, but thank you guys. Let's turn to some of the questions. Nancy has said so many new docs are being produced, but budgets are often small. How does that factor into pricing? So not all documentaries are as successful as RBG. Is it similar to the way editorial images are priced with stills? And not really, right? I mean, what would you guys, how would you answer that?
I think budgets have to factor in. We don't ask what are the, when licensees come, we don't get what's their budget. We don't ask that, they won't
true.
Tell.
That's true.
And it's really none of our, I think, you know, we don't disclose if you're a client, but you need to take it in as a factor. I think I said that earlier. And figure out if what is affordable. If this is your price, how much are you going to wiggle? Is it they're using 5 seconds or are they using 5 minutes? And there's a whole different conversation to those who are not a clip-based library. I mean, there's a good portion here, which, you know, it's click and buy, and it's a very different type of a license where in a rights managed because of the copyright and because of the nature of the library itself, which we don't need to go into now. It just is a factor you need to sort of look at. And again, budgets haven't changed, and that's a big, huge issue.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think that was another point someone made here, you know, that the budget, you know, in the early days of, Leslie was saying, the early days of web content, there were no budgets to speak of, so prices started very low. You know, but now everyone wants everything. But as Jessica said, I don't think anyone's raised their rates in 10 years. So, you know, I think we're trying to work with the creators, and by not raising our rates, but you could argue, well, maybe we should be raising our rates. I don't know.
In the early days of web, it was a very narrow thing. You know, people actually licensed for very narrow, wasn't all streaming, wasn't this, it was maybe you were doing a very small platform.
Can you see this?
Yeah.
So
yes,
we're doing, just to go to a touch on a point that Ed made earlier, we actually represent Fox Movietone, which has 36 million feet of film that hasn't been digitized.
I've used it and it's amazing.
Yeah. And 35 millimeter, I mean, it looks better than something that was shot 10 years ago.
Absolutely.
So it's incredible. This is a survey. It's not quite complete, but this is a survey that we did of our affiliate stations. So these are the local stations. And we found 40,000 hours of U-matic.
God.
That is...
horrifying.
horrifying is the word.
There are 300,000 hours of betas in just 17 stations. It's gonna cost us, we're working on a project now, just to do half of the U-matics is $2 million.
Oh my
God. So, you know,
the quality is questionable.
Well, I mean, we're getting the best, you're right. I mean, you're talking about the ENG era, which was intentionally disposable. You know, it was meant to be reused and thrown out, I mean, to save money.
But one of the most, the least documented decades, but one of the most difficult decades,
right,
to substantiate with footage because of this disposable media as a resource side.
That's definitely true.
So there's a huge value even at like a B level of quality.
Right.
You've got to do it.
Yeah, and the fact of the matter is, Ed may not appreciate it, but I mean, he will after I mentioned that the decks are gone. I mean, there's no decks left to play these.
Oh no, I completely.
You know, so it's not only
completely. You have to find them, right? It's amazing.
Right, and the parts aren't available. No one makes the parts. They're hoarding parts. So we're identifying the vendors that have these parts and the decks to play these, and you know, the tapes sometimes. The state of them, you know, they've been in these damp basements and they need to be, baked. You've got to reactivate.
Is the word. Right.
I'm starting to get messages.
I know. We're going to have to wrap up. But I mean, right before we leave, I do just quickly want to address. Abby has said one thing that licensing parties really need is a commitment to the administrative part of being a vendor of such content, because relicensing does take a lot of time and effort. We need to know that a licensor will commit to handling relicensing negotiations in a timely manner by committing resources to handling the business end. And I think we're all, at least from our end, quickly, one of the issues is that sometimes we do have to dig things out.
I just want to say one thing about that.
Yeah.
Those of us who have been around for a while, yes, the problem is so many libraries have moved to new arrangements and new ownership and new affiliations that the agreements that existed or the provisions for which were the underlying agreements no longer are valid. That's the problem. You know, a Fox has been around and several other libraries, yes, absolutely will commit to relicensing. If they can, whoever licensed it maybe 10 years ago might not be the current licensor. There is a huge problem of figuring out, and that's, you know, I've worked on some of those projects and that's the nightmare. Yeah. So, and that's a whole other problem, of consolidation and movement and who cares about their product and who doesn't.
Exactly. We have relationships with our material. We know that material, from a personal point of view, you know, it's, and then if you're just treating it as a commodity, as like a, you know, a widget, then that's what you get. But if you're speaking to archives and archivists who know what the value of that footage is and appreciate it, it's a totally different, you know, you're going to get a different level of service and product from that.
That's why perpetuity is important. Yes, that's why.
That's right.
10 years ago, no one thought it mattered.
No one could even get their head around that. But now
that's why people threw away their 2-inch masters. They cost too much to store. They never thought the importance of the future of history.
Anyway, this has just been a great discussion, everyone. I'm afraid I'm getting a lot of notes that we need to finish up. And I just want to thank our panelists and thank everyone for attending. It's been really interesting. And it'll be fascinating to see what happens in the next 6 months to a year.
We'll do this again next year.
Exactly. Thank you all very much.
Thank you,
Allison.
Thank you. Thanks, Allison.
Yeah.